Right to Reason podcast. I'm your host, Robert Stanley. Today we're debating whether or not the Bible is true. We reference John Locke and his contribution to epistemology.
Following in the tradition of the likes of Francis Bacon, was an empiricist. Indeed, probably his best known work, An Essay Concerning Human Understanding, 1689, is one of the first great defences of empiricism, and concerns itself with determining the limits of human understanding in respect to a wide spectrum of topics. As he argues, no man's knowledge here can go beyond his experience. It thus tells us, in some detail, what one can legitimately claim to know and what one cannot. Linked to this is Locke's so-called theory of mind, which is often cited as the origin of modern conceptions of identity and the self. Locke was the first to define the self through a continuity of consciousness, arguing that the mind was a tabula rasa, a blank slate, which became filled with knowledge deriving from experience, observation, and experimentation. This was in contrast to the pre-existing Cartesian philosophy, which stated that we are born with innate ideas.
Sam Harris and Jordan Peterson debated this very topic. Jordan, like my guest today, appeals to evolution to describe truth as something other than simple empiricism. Sam disagrees.
See, what you're doing is that you're taking a way of looking at the world, and you're making a micro example out of it, and you're saying that within the context of that micro example, truth is not malleable by situations. Like, okay, I buy it. But the problem is that micro example isn't separate in the actual world from the macro examples, which would be, let's call it, the scientific method as such. And there may be local applications of the scientific method where the local facts generated are sufficiently, context independent so that you can't make any contextual claims. But I could say, well, it turned out in 1,000 years that entire empirical game was fatal. Mm-hmm. And so then I would say, well, the micro parts of it were fatal too. You just couldn't see it.
I agree about the non-utility of playing fatal games, right? So we don't want to play games that will get us all killed reliably, certainly if there's no huge benefit on the other side.
From a scientific perspective, why not?
But then you're just saying that, is there a scientific reason to want to exist or to want your kids to live happy lives as opposed to die in their sleep tonight?
Yes, that is partly what I'm saying, yes.
We can talk about that, but it seems to me we can't just skip over this question of truth because it anchors everything else
but another thing to do would, look, fair enough, and we could argue about it for quite a while, and I think the danger is that we'll sidetrack the entire conversation doing this, and that won't be so useful. So what I would recommend is that we could recognize for the moment that we're starting with different claims of truth.
But I don't think we are. I think you're simply deciding at the end of the day to say that any truths that led us down a path where we suffered unnecessarily or died weren't true.
Right. You have to choose what you mean by true. You have to. And I'm not accepting the same definition of truth that you operate under, because it's partly because I believe that Darwin trumps realism, let's say. I believe that pragmatism trumps realism.
But what happens when we add the question of truth to the Holy Bible? Is the Bible true? Here's Frank Turek's answer.
A lot of people are skeptical of God's word. Uh-huh. Why can we trust the Bible?
Well, let me give you a real short answer, because it's true and there's evidence for it. First of all, we know God exists. There's evidence that the universe exploded into being out of nothing. So if the first verse of the Bible is true, every other verse is at least believable. So we live in a theistic universe. I mean, if God exists, it's possible he rose Jesus from the dead. So anti-supernaturalism is unwarranted. When we have the first verse in the Bible as being true, maybe the other verses are true. Now, there's a lot of evidence we cover in our book, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. But briefly, one of the most persuasive pieces of evidence to me as to why the Bible is true is because there's embarrassing testimony in it. Mm-hmm. these New Testament writers wouldn't have made themselves out to look like stupid, uncaring, rebuked cowards who ran away while the brave women were the discoverers of the empty tomb. What man would have made that up? Yeah. Nobody would have made that up. Men wrote it down and said that they were fearful, they were rebuked. Their leader was called Satan by Jesus. Their leader denied Christ three times. And then they run away while the brave women go down and discover the empty tomb. You wouldn't have made that up. I wouldn't have made that up. No man would have made that up. That's just good evidence that they were really telling the truth.
Good answer.
I'm going to speak with philosophy graduate Alex Moreschi today. He believes the question itself is flawed and focuses on the truth of the Bible as more of a metaphor, the validity within myth itself. But I want to know if the stories of the Bible really happened or not. It's my job today to pin him down and get to the brass tacks. Let's see if I can do it.
It's the Right to Reason podcast.
I'm Alex Moreschi, and you have the right to reason.
This episode of the Right to Reason podcast is brought to you by our patrons and contributors like me. We have all recognized the value of the unrestrained marketplace of ideas and have decided to make a difference. You can make a difference too. Contribute at patreon.com/right and learn more about your right to reason at therighttoreason.com. Your activism is appreciated.
Alex Moreschi, how you doing, man?
I'm doing just fine. How are you?
I'm awesome, dude. I'm so happy to be talking to you. Just in case anyone wants to kind of get an understanding of who you are before we get rocking and rolling, well, are you like a double major or something? Or did you actually get two degrees at two different times?
No, well, no, I got two degrees at the same time. That is heavy. I was a bit overzealous.
Yeah, so philosophy, which my listeners are already, they already got a hard on for you, but also evolutionary biology, which is fascinating. Yeah. So you're kind of like Richard Dawkins meets Dan Dennett, but
well,
not
atheist.
And then
I went to seminary, so.
Yeah, and seminary, so okay. So you're,
well, you know, Darwin went to an Anglican seminary before he got on the Beagle.
Really? I didn't know that. All right, so you are one of these Christians, Episcopalian, correct?
Yep.
And you are you a rector? Is that the proper?
So the Episcopal Church likes to name things all different stuff. The rector is somebody that's in charge of a church. I'm not in charge of any congregation. I do hospice chaplaincy as my main work right now.
Okay. So Episcopal minister, Episcopal chaplain, something like that. I've debated an Episcopalian rector before. He was a nice guy. He was really polite. He didn't have your comfortability with doing this sort of thing. You've been on a lot of podcasts, right?
Yeah.
Who all have you been on?
It would take me a minute because it's actually
forever.
Been a little bit.
But a lot of atheist podcasts.
No Religion Required. I did that quite a bit. In fact, I kind of helped co-host that for the latter like year of it to see the Skeptics Brew Pub, I think I was on. I did. There are lots of atheist podcasts that are like the something atheist and stuff.
Oh,
so,
the Barroom Atheist? I remember that one.
Yeah, I did that one.
How in the world do you become a co-host on an atheist podcast if you're a theist? How does that even work?
Man, it just kind of happened organically. The other couple hosts were living in Savannah. I had known them. I'd been on it. And then they did their shows live, which I really loved. That was kind of when I got involved, when they really switched to the live shows, because I could engage in the immediate. They did the thing where you could write in chat room and stuff.
Yeah.
And I just started engaging, and they would then just sort of bring me on and say, why don't you just call in and we'll just talk it out. And then it just kind of happened where I was doing that every week. And
well, I heard some of that earlier.
I've known them for several years. And I think that one of the things that happened was that one of the female host, Ashley's stepfather got very sick and did die. And so did her mom. And I was a chaplain at the hospital, the big trauma center in the area, and I was there with them both times, and I think that sort of built the relationship and the sort of respect between us.
That's heavy, man.
Well, it goes to show you that it's rarely do people, I think, connect over argumentation. Even though I enjoy argument, I like doing it. I think that we connect over these interpersonal experiences, and that's sort of what builds those lasting bonds.
Finding common ground through experience and just humanity itself, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Who was the other Episcopalian? I'm curious.
Oh, now you're putting me on the spot. I can't remember his name.
You did. You put me on the spot.
I can't remember his name. I feel horrible about it now.
Where was he from, at least?
Texas. You know, like he's a Texas guy. But you're in Georgia?
Yeah, I'm in South Georgia.
So I live in Texas now, but I'm a Georgia boy at heart, man. I'm from Warner Robins, Georgia.
All right, yeah.
Yeah, so around the Macon area.
I'm about an hour and a half south of there. I went to Mercer, actually.
Yeah, yeah. I know Mercer. Very, very prestigious school.
Yeah.
So, expensive. Okay. Where do we even start with this? Because I got so many questions. You believe in evolution.
I acknowledge evolution.
You used to bartend while you were going to seminary.
Yeah.
You acknowledge evolution. Oh, I guess we all acknowledge evolution that believe.
I think that's important.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Our language matters. And I'm a big believer. I think that's the philosophy. You know, if I learned one thing from that, it's that our language matters. And evolution is something that happened.
Okay, hold on. Do you accept that we evolved from common ancestors like chimpanzees and bonobos and that we're primates?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. I've talked to so many theists that are like, oh, I'm okay with evolution, sure, or microevolution, you know, or something like that. Like, no, that's not, don't even semantics. But okay, so you're legit. You're like a modern style Christian, but you're still
actually, Darwin's one of my heroes. I got my first tattoo about 6 months ago, and it's been one I've been planning for a while. And finally, a friend kind of talked me into doing it. And it's on my right forearm, and it's actually it's a page out of Darwin's notebook. And it's this cladistic tree that begins with, I think. And my dad took me to a museum in Philadelphia when I was a kid to actually see this diary. We got to go in the back and take a look at this diary. And that's just been one of the more formative things, because here's a man that didn't do a proof like Einstein, but just had an idea. I mean, he just, I think this is right. And it turns out that shapes the course of humanity perhaps more than any other thing in the last couple thousand years. And I love that an idea can change the world.
Are you familiar with author Dr. Hector A. Garcia? He wrote this book called Alpha God, The Psychology of Religious Violence and Oppression. He looked through the evolutionary process and said, how can we look at our primate history and understand how God, the concept of God, could have been generated from that? I'm going to read you this quick excerpt from the book, and I want to get your opinion on this, okay? Actually had him on the show in the past. Really cool guy. He's coming back on. Just in case any listeners enjoyed that last conversation, he's coming back on. He's in the middle of a new book where he's taking our evolutionary history as primates, as crazy tribalistic monkey people, and how that doesn't just explain God. Now he's using that to explain our politics. So that's going to be a lot of fun. That's going to be more of a political bend on it, on the same theme. All right, here we go. It was once believed that the brain was an all-purpose problem-solving mechanism that was a blank slate from birth, and that all of our mental capacities were entirely learned. This notion of a blank slate, or tabula rasa, was passed down into Western and Middle Eastern thought by Greek philosophers and was made popular by English philosopher John Locke in his seminal work, An Essay Concerning Human Understanding. What we have since learned about the mind lends itself into why we see our gods as alpha males. So he continues on, that's right in the first chapter, he continues on to show that whenever we were real tribalistic, that we were accelerating, you know, certain alpha males of the group to be the leaders, and that this person would control women, you know, women's rights issues that you could find throughout much of religion, that we would become violent, that they would become violent territorially, in the same way that, you know, if we were to read the Old Testament, that might make a lot of sense in that sense. You know, whether or not your men should have their heads at large display, he goes over the head display and explains why we wear hats today. Really fascinating stuff. And then you think about the religious people, they always have like these big extravagant hats, you know, ordained with jewels and whatnot. And it's kind of a neat idea, man. So, I mean, could that to you explain in a way how we created God rather than God created us?
I would sort of ask a few questions. I mean, for one, I think, as I remember it, the folk like Owen Lovejoy and Tim White, sort of leading biological anthropologists, and this is I'm going back like 8 or 9 years here, so some of the information might either be outdated or with holes in my memory, but hypothesized and stated that we probably evolved not from sort of pan troglodytes, the common chimp where they have alpha males and stuff like that, but from bonobo chimps, which operate in a very different way. Human beings have very low sexual dimorphism, right? We don't tend to, so what I mean is that we can act as a from a psychologist's point of view, it would be important to recognize that we're using the lens of alpha male when that may not always be appropriate. I think that it's worth noting. Okay. Just from our understanding. I mean, this is they discovered Ardipithecus rambidus, and that really kind of shifted a lot of how we thought about that. So I think that we can absolutely see where our understanding of God has come from and has evolved and changed and shifted. I mean, we didn't really have our modern understanding of like heaven and hell until Dante, right? Sure. I mean, there is a history of this here that has developed and changed.
So how do you explain something? Like, let's take Dante, for instance. Totally extra-biblical kind of understanding of a biblical concept, right? Uh-huh. And in the same sense as you say, well, I accept that maybe some of our concepts of the divine evolved socially from our physical evolution as well. So in that sense, how do you know where to draw the line between truth and something that just came about over time?
Yeah, well, so in part, at least, what you're talking about is epistemology, right? You're talking about how we know what we know.
But not just epistemology, generally speaking. I mean about God himself. Like, are there parts of the Bible that you could look at and say, I know Christ died, buried, resurrected, and that he was God incarnate? Like, is that something that you can know, whereas other parts of the Bible you say, well, I kind of take the creation story, you know, metaphorically, but I take the Christ story, the gospel, I take that literally. Like, do you have some kind of conflict there? Is there like a litmus test that you can perform where you know, like...
Right. So the question of knowledge, right? There are different kinds of knowledge. I do think this is in general. You're right that there's more specifics to the epistemology there, but a couple things. One, I think it's important to note that something like the Nicene Creed, for example, that many traditions around the world say, it starts off with "I believe" or "we believe," right? And I think that that's important that we remember that there may be a distinction between believe and know, and that is important. I think an important distinction. Also, that you're talking about John Locke, right? John Locke's essays concerning human understanding. Mm-hmm. This did start this idea in the Enlightenment, right? John Locke and Thomas Hobbes and these guys really begin this shift in Western civilization. After Locke, you've got David Hume, who wrote a book that's very similar, right? It's an inquiry concerning human understanding, not essays concerning human understanding. But in it, that's where Hume kind of really lays out why people think what they think. And he actually has a section that I love called On Miracles. And he said that human beings work off of probability. The reason that we can walk around and do so, even though we know we might fall through the floor, the reason we can walk is that we know it's not probable that this is the case. And at one point, he's got this really witty line that says, the real miracle is that people believe in miracles at all. That people believe in things that go against the probability. And he kind of leaves it there. And I've often thought about that. And part of this is a tangent, but I think it loops back around to this distinction between know and belief. That there is a distinction, and that just because something is not empirical doesn't mean that it is not real.
Sure. It could be normative, right? Where we're saying you should do this or you should do that. It's not necessarily something we can say, hey, there's two apples there. If we add another apple, it's three. But in the same way, like, I'm kind of wondering, how do you know that God exists? Or do you just believe it?
Well, I guess that's the distinction that I'm trying to make, right? Is that we tend to look at belief as something lesser than no. And I think it is different, but I don't think that it is a lesser extent. I think these are two different things.
Well, knowledge is a subset of belief, right?
Maybe. Maybe they're two just distinct things, two distinct ways of engaging the world around us. And we use the words interchangeably a lot, and perhaps they are. That's why I kind of said, I don't believe in evolution. I acknowledge it, right? I've been in labs. I've seen this stuff happen. I've seen the evidence of it and all of that. Whereas I could say that I believe that so-and-so is in love with me, right? And my girlfriend's in love with me, right? And to some extent, I know that. But that's not an empirical thing, right? So if knowledge is only empirical, then it would be more appropriate to say that I believe that to be the case. Do you see the distinction?
No. Once again, as a subset, you can believe that the sun is outside, but you don't know it till you see it. So you have a belief, but it is confirmed by empirical data. And once that occurs, then you have knowledge. Justified true belief would be the definition of that. So it has to be true for it to be knowledge. It has to be justifiable. And it is beyond question. It is a belief. I don't know that.
So the question here then is, let's go back, and if we go back in history, right? There were folk that would have said, I know that, fill in the blank, I know that the earth is flat, and I know this because, look, my senses are telling me that is the case.
They can say that, but they're wrong. They don't
right.
know.
Wrong. Absolutely. They are wrong.
So the fact that it is not a true justified belief, one, it probably not justified, but we could argue about that, but it's certainly not true. So it can't be knowledge.
So, okay. So it can't be knowledge. If I were to describe, something, if we go into sort of poetry, or if we go into the realm of mythology, and I don't mean that in the sense of that a lot of people, I think, use the term myth, but more like Joseph Campbell using the term myth, that myth can relay truth that cannot be relayed through a factual accounting.
Oh, like a metaphorical truth, like modern
right.
Eric Weinstein kind of stuff.
Yeah, that we can gain
Jordan
more
Peterson
from...
Jordan Peterson kind of stuff. Is that where we're going here?
say that one more time.
Like a Jordan Peterson thing?
Jordan Peterson.
Yeah, you know, like, well, I don't know. Yeah. It's real popular with the kind of right-leaning philosophy, psychology guys, political pundit talking head guys that they say that the Bible has metaphorical truth, more or less. I shouldn't have cut you off, but I was just asking, is that kind of where we're starting to lean in the conversation, where you say that maybe it's true, maybe it's not? Maybe
yeah, somewhat, but the distinction that I would make is, because I think that a lot of the sort of conservative Christians make a similar sort of flaw. They try to fit what was never intended to be history, or I guess if you're calling it knowledge, into that. One of the examples that comes up a lot, right? Was it Daniel or David? It was one or the other that stopped the sun in the sky. Mm-hmm. And that the sun stopped for this period of time or something like that, so that they could continue the battle. I don't remember the details, but that's brought up a lot.
Yeah,
and it says,
and
you can't stop the sun in the sky, right? The people that wrote that down know that you can't stop the sun in the sky.
Really?
Like, yeah.
What would make you
this
think
was
that
never
they...
intended to be? It was not intended to be a historical accounting. Remember that modern history looks at the past very differently.
Why would you assume that people from the Bronze Age would have any understanding of that sort of thing? These were idiots.
The Egyptians knew that the world was round well before Galileo. I mean, 15, 2, 3,000 years, right? I mean, I don't know that we give people in our past enough credit. So here's perhaps a better example. Right? Let's look at the creation
stories.
They
knew the world was round. BC here actually knew the world was round. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, through astronomy.
They drew pictures of like Ra taking a boat, you know, up and changing out the sun and the moon in a canoe. And, you know, like with a dog head. So I always just kind of assumed that they were... They were morons, but I mean, they were smart enough to make the pyramids, right?
Could be wrong on that. A better example would be the stories in Genesis of the creation stories, right?
Yeah, you have chapter one. I wanted to ask you about that. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
So chapter one and chapter two are mutually exclusive of one another, right? They do not overlap. They don't fit.
Right.
But the people writing them down. And they don't even make sense, right? They knew that light came from the sun. They knew that they got day and night through the sun and the moon and the stars. And yet the source of light is not created until, what, day three or four? It doesn't even make sense.
Because they're morons.
No. I don't think so. I think this is intentional.
I can totally understand how just looking at the majority of human history and going, oh, well, they're stupid and I'm smart, is probably not a good objective understanding of humanity. Yeah. So I get that you are probably more right than wrong about this. But I also, at the same time, I feel like you're giving a lot of credence to people that believed you could put striped sticks in the ground and have goats fuck in front of it and they become striped. Yeah. You know, like, I don't know.
No,
throwing that out as an example, but, you know.
There were a lot of things several thousand years ago that people were stupid about, absolutely, or didn't know, rather, ignorant of. I'm absolutely on board. I mean, you know, around the time of Darwin, you've got Lamarck, right, saying that giraffes have long necks because they stretch their necks up into the trees. And, I mean, now that just sounds completely absurd to us, and that wasn't all that long ago.
Well, to you, people that hadn't studied evolution at all would probably find that to be pretty compelling.
But you're
one of those smart guys, Alex.
But my point is this, that there are even hints within this. The writers and the people that collected the stories in Genesis knew that these two things contradicted. This is obvious. And what they would say, and this is, again, this is where the Enlightenment kind of changes the way we see the world. What they would say is that the facts of it don't matter. It's the truth within it.
How do you determine
thing is relaying?
The truth in it, though? How does that happen?
That is a good question. And different people think different things, right? The Episcopal Church, of which I'm a part, would talk about things like scripture, tradition, and reason, right? Saying that there are multiple sorts of lenses, which is really just a way of differentiating between authority on some level and one's own empirical and rational or logical understanding. So, for example, I've never been to Paris, right? Do I know that Paris exists or not?
I would say that you do know Paris exists, not just based on whether or not you've been there, but you do have evidence that it exists.
Right. And what is that evidence?
I don't know. Maps, stories, movies, what have you.
Sure. And primarily that other people have told me that it exists, right?
Sure.
I mean, this people that I consider to be credible and learned, that I give authority to, have told me that this is the case. We do this in science all the time, right? We're not going back and retesting Galileo's theories or retesting Newton outside of a, you know, freshman physics class, because we take it for granted, right? We take it that the folk that have come before us, we trust that they tested and retested their results and that they have some truth value to this, and credence and authority on this matter. Could it be an elaborate lie, an elaborate hoax? I mean, sure, but we work off of probability. We work off of what is likely.
Okay, what if only 66 people, your whole life, only 66 people told you that Paris existed, but each of these 66 people also told you that they had a pet dragon? or that they perform miracles, or that a man can live in a fish for 3 days, or that Noah's Ark collected kangaroos. So, I mean, like, you've got 66 books in the Bible telling you that the Christian God is real and that he came out of Judaism, but every one of those books has also got stuff that I would think would invalidate their claim. In the same way that if I told you, I have a dragon in my garage and I also like to go fishing, you'd say, well, you're a liar, so I don't know about the fishing thing. But if I said, I have a motorcycle in my garage and I like to go fishing, you'd say, ah, let me know what you catch. Because it wouldn't be a big deal. But I would feel like if 66 people told you Paris existed and that was your only reference, and each of those people also tried to BS you with some kind of metaphorical truth from a miracle story that's impossible to believe, that you wouldn't believe Paris exists, and you'd have justifiable reason to doubt that.
Well, it's impossible to believe, and yet, you know, billions of people across the last couple thousand years have believed it, which is, and I'm not saying that to say that that means that it's more true. I'm saying that to say that it's obviously not impossible to believe, at least on some level.
No, it's just not rational.
So, again, it depends on what we're talking about here. I really do think that when we're describing something, so let's look at your example of a motorcycle, right? How do you feel when you're driving your motorcycle?
Well, I don't actually have a motorcycle.
Oh, I thought you had one. Oh, that doesn't work then.
But if I did have one, and I do intend to get one, even though the wife is telling me I'm not allowed. But that just makes me want one even more. She should have been like, sure, baby, get one. I think you're going to be totally safe on it. And then it would just never happen. But then when she's like, you can't do that, I'm like, oh, my God, that motorcycle's going to feel so good now. But, yeah, I mean, I get where you're going with that. I feel great, wind blowing in my hair, free. I think I'm one of the cool guys on Sons of Anarchy. I've got abs.
Yeah, perhaps a way of describing that might be, I feel like I'm riding a dragon. Yeah.
Huh?
I'm saying perhaps a way of thinking about it would be, I feel like I'm riding a dragon.
All right.
We both have an idea of what a dragon would be, some concept of that. And if I tell you that for me, it feels like I'm riding a dragon every time I'm on my motorcycle, you can get all sorts of things out of that, can't you?
Yeah.
Right. So
this is a weird way to go here. I'm following.
It is weird. And I'm not even sure that it's going to work, but I'm not sure it's going to work, but let's try it.
Who is this guy?
We may get a minute down the way and
I'm following. All right. I'm on my motorcycle. It feels like I'm riding a dragon and you're going to tie this together.
Right. So if we say that, what does that mean?
I don't know. You got to lead this one, brother.
Let's just
take
a guess.
I'm following wherever you're going.
We'll flip it. And I'll say to you, you say, oh, you've got a motorcycle. I really would like to get one, but my wife won't let me get one, et cetera. what's it like having a motorcycle? And my response is, you know, it feels like I'm riding a dragon.
Okay.
What do you think that means? What could you infer from that?
It's an expressive way of saying that it makes you feel empowered and free.
Yeah, and could you extrapolate more?
No.
So perhaps, you know, talking about wind in face and flying, okay. It feels like I'm flying.
Yeah, it feels like, okay.
It feels that there's, that this is a beast beneath me that has kind of a life and a mind of its own. I think that there are all sorts of things that we can go from by that kind of statement. I mean, Emily Dickinson was sort of famous for saying like, or snow is like a white blanket. Right. Snow is not a blanket. This is Ogden Nash's response in his pithy fashion said that, you know, you sleep under your 6 inches of snow and I'll sleep under my half inch of unpoetical blanket material and we'll see which one stays warm. But what is going on there when we say that the snow is a blanket? We are talking about something that goes beyond sort of talking about the particular space that those molecules are taking up in space. It is an example of our language falling short.
So the creation story is a simile, more or less. In the same way, it feels like I'm on a dragon. But my problem is certain things in the Bible don't have the word like or as preceding them. You know what I mean? So it's right. Kind of like, it's making emphatic claims and people kill each other over this. In fact, it affects even your life, a nonviolent, totally cool guy that I'm enjoying talking to, but it affects you in such a way that it actually leads you to believe that there's a life after this one, that there's somebody that can listen to your prayers, that there's such a thing as a thought crime, for instance, where you might be able to have a bad thought.
Thought crime?
But yeah, I mean, if...
I'm like, unfamiliar with
well,
the...
Maybe it's a bad way of describing it. But, you know, Sermon on the Mount, where he says, if you've been told not to kill one another, but if you even think about killing someone in your head, that's bad. Or you've been told not to bang the neighbor lady, but if you even think about her, that's a bad thing. You know, if you think about her in a sexual way.
Yeah, it is better to pluck out your eye than to look with lust on someone else, right?
Yeah, like that whole thing. Are really horrible implications because the Bible isn't a simile. It actually gives us moral instructions and tells us who we can and can't kill and what we can and can't eat, what kind of linens we should have.
Okay, you know, so the first thing to remember, I think, too, is that first and foremost, I think that the Bible and I would argue all scripture from any tradition is a record of human beings attempting to understand the divine. Even if the divine has no truth value to it and is merely a concept, it's human beings' perception and lenses, right? It's multiple people across, in the Bible's case, a couple thousand years, recording their understanding of their experiences.
That would be all religious texts would fall underneath that definition,
so.
Right?
The only people that would give me grief would be my Muslim brothers and sisters, and we'd just have to part ways on that one.
Yeah.
So it has to be then seen through that lens, right? We have to recognize that the laws and instructions and these sorts of things are written by a particular group of people for a particular group of people in a particular time in a particular place for a particular reason. One of the things that bugs me the most about a lot of sort of modern Christians is that they look to something like the book of Revelation and they say, oh, it's this thing coming up in the future and blah, 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 blah. And it's like, no, the guy was talking about Rome. He was talking about the Roman Empire. Any more than Star Trek is talking about what we really truly believe that this is what our actual future is going to look like. No, it's providing a mirror. It's removing something from the perhaps factual statements so that we can better have a grasp and an understanding of what's going on. That meaning goes beyond the arrangement of particles.
Okay. How do you know when it's true or it's just some kind of metaphor with an underlying truth that we can kind of glean from it, sort of?
So, and that's again, like, right, and I'm not trying to be difficult here. I've been sort of accused of dodging the question and stuff, but I think that when we say that there's no such thing as sort of a mere metaphor, that I'm not making a distinction between something that is describing the reality as it is perceived with truth. I'm not saying that one is true and the other isn't. These things are both true.
But
one way of looking at it perhaps is light a particle or a wave, right? We have different definitions of particle and wave. The two things are mutually exclusive. Is light a particle or a wave? And the truth is, well, it's both. and sure. neither sort of, right?
But that's a true statement.
This way. What?
That is a true emphatic statement. My question to you is, did Christ die on the cross and rise again, allowing forgiveness for your sins, literally or metaphorically?
And that's where I'm saying I don't make that distinction.
Then you can't be a Christian.
Why not?
Because a Christian believes Christ really died on the cross and really rose again and really saves them.
Right? I do believe that there was a human being,
that one's not a
Jesus
metaphor.
Of Nazareth, kicking around in Palestine.
Right. So that's not a metaphor.
First century CE.
So that's not a metaphor.
No, that part's not. Okay. Not.
How do you tell the difference between metaphor and literal truth in the Bible? How do you draw that distinction?
Well, I think there are lots of different ways. Context is really important. Whether or not there's sort of a reason to look at something otherwise, right? If we say that whoever it was stopped the sun in the sky for 5 hours, right? We've never seen the sun stop in the sky, so maybe there's something more going on there. What is that person that is writing this down trying to relay to the people that are receiving it and hearing it?
You discount something if it's not something we've seen before?
Well, I'm not discounting it, right?
I haven't seen anybody raised from the dead.
There's something else going on there. I'm not discounting it. I'm just saying that the factuality of that to me doesn't matter.
Okay,
I'm not saying that.
Let me rephrase. You move it from the place of literal to metaphorical truth. Is that fair enough? If it's something that you say, we've never seen this before, we have no empirical evidence that this actually occurred, then at that time, that's how you litmus test the difference between literal and metaphorical in the Bible. Would that be fair? I don't want a straw man.
Yeah,
I'm trying to
know.
Actually,
I got you. And I'm trying to relay this in the best way that I can. So if we're talking about empirical stuff, right? I'm asking the question, is this making an empirical claim? If it's making an empirical claim, do I have reason to doubt that empirical claim? If I do, what more is going on there?
Okay, well, you clearly have reason to doubt.
What is that person trying to relay?
That Jesus is God and that he died for your sins. You have a lot of reasons to doubt that.
Is that an empirical claim?
Yes. In fact, you even said that was a literal truth, and therefore it's
empirical.
Oh, no,
I said it was a literal truth that there was a man of Jesus of Nazareth kicking around first century Palestine, CE, right?
Whoa. So you're saying
say that
you don't
God,
even...
That God is found in the person of Jesus Christ, I don't think that is an empirical claim. I don't think that's something that can be measured. I don't think God is something that can be measured.
How can that be anything other than an empirical claim? That Christ was born of a virgin, that when in his 30s, he performed miracles, that he died, that he was resurrected, ascended to heaven, and saves us from our sins. And if we don't follow him, if we don't believe in him and accept his gift of salvation, then we will literally burn in hell. That's all empirical.
So,
and if you don't think that's empirical, Alex, I don't think you're a real Christian.
So again, there are different kinds of Christians. The God that the Southern Baptists believe in is not the God that I believe in.
That's fair. I mean, you're not Catholic either. I get that, man.
No, I'm not Catholic either.
You have to at least accept the gospel message.
I do accept the gospel message.
But is it true?
I do accept the gospel message.
Is it true?
I just may have a different understanding of what that message is.
Is it true?
Is what true? The gospel? Absolutely.
Okay. How do you differentiate between the gospel and Genesis? Because both of them make empirical claims.
Oh, I think
both of
that
them
Genesis
are,
is true
are
too.
Hard to believe without faith.
Well, I think that Genesis is true too.
Metaphorically.
It's true.
Metaphorically.
Why is there a distinction?
That's a major difference. That's a major difference. The Matrix has a lot of truth metaphorically to it, but I'm not going to teach it in a science class. In the same way,
the like, two things are doing completely different things.
You don't think that we should...
It would be wrong to, I mean, it would be wrong to ask, you know, a scientist to make meaning out of the thing that they have done. Just like it would be, I think, it would definitely be wrong to have a religious class to say, look at the Buddhist bodhisattvas, right? And say, okay, is this empirically true? It would be missing the point in both cases.
In terms of what is literally real and true, you believe that Jesus really turned water to wine, right?
And see, that's the thing. You're using this, you're using literally to mean empirically. What I would say is that we didn't get sort of down my litmus test, which I think that there is farther points to it. One of the points that somewhere along the way would be how much does this matter? How much does this impact the way that I behave, the way that I act, that, you know, all of these other things, right? A classic example was, as you brought up earlier, was Jesus born of a virgin? So in Greek, the word doesn't even mean virgin. It just means young girl. This was a mistranslation, but yet has been adopted into the majority of Christianity. And it is seen as a doctrine of the church, right?
Right.
Born of a virgin. I mean, we have it in our creeds. And it comes from this. So what I would say is that was Mary literally a virgin? I don't know. I don't.
Okay, that's fair.
But
are certain things that you do like really believe really, really happen. And I'm wondering, how do you differentiate between those and whether or not Mary was getting banged at 12 years old or not?
Again, I'm asking different questions. I'm not trying to ask the same question of both.
You're not answering my question, man.
Because I don't agree with the question itself. I'm not answering it because I think don't
it's like
think
a trick
that,
question, like when just stop beating your wife kind of question, like it's a setup.
No, I don't think it's a setup. No, not at all. I think that the definitions are not that we're not using the same language.
Okay.
I think in my mind, we're not using the same language. And so when you're asking if something is true, you are making it synonymous with empirical. When I am asking if something is true, I am not so much looking at the empirical nature of it as I am the impact of the thing.
Would it be better if we just avoided the word true so that there wouldn't be any confusion?
Sure. Okay, let's avoid that for a minute.
Okay. Well, if we just said literal and metaphorical.
Right, we can do that. Or perhaps myth might be a better word.
Literal and mythical.
Right. The problem with myth these days is, again, we see myth and the symbolic as something that is lesser than the physical. We see it as less true, less real, rather, if we're not using true, less real.
Because it is. It is less real. If I go to my doctor and he tells me something mythical, I might die, depending on how I interpret his story. But I need real drugs, and I need it to be really helpful.
So, yes, that is empirical. I agree that we have data to support this. Something can be real without being empirical, right?
By real, you mean exist without being something that we can empirically prove?
Yeah.
Like a synthetic a priori kind of thing? Or if you said...
Maybe not a priori. No, just something can be real without being empirical.
A concept, for instance, is a real concept, but I can't prove it with the senses.
Sure.
Okay.
I'm with you. One thing to go back to would be love, right? Kindness or patriotism, right? This thing is real, and it is affecting the way that people act around our country right now. But it's not an empirical thing.
Okay, sure.
But that doesn't mean that it's not real. And I guess for me, in my mind, I'm not trying to convince anyone to be a theist. And I want to start with that. I have no interest in converting anyone. That is not something that I am concerned or really interested in. I am not in the business of saving souls. What I am in the business of doing is helping others to be the best version of themselves that they can be, is being present for others, helping them find a community that both lifts them up, loves them, and also challenges them. And that's real, right? We grow and get better, I think. I know that I have changed. And that's not an empirical thing. I don't think that can be measured. But it doesn't mean that it's not real. The experiences that we can have can be very real without necessarily being empirical. They can affect the course of our lives. We can have a interaction or a relationship or a bond that sort of goes beyond the empirical, but that affects us. I mean, the idea of looking at Darwin's notebook and seeing that this one simple idea, this record of this moment in time, went to change the course of human history, that means something to me. That is real. But there's not really an empirical sense to that. I mean, I could trace the history and little steps and all of this sort of thing, but there's something in my mind, in my perception, in my lens, that's beyond that or different from that.
Alex Moreschi, you have a really cool voice, and I could listen to you for hours, dude. I love the way you talk. It's almost poetic.
It is poetic.
You pissed me off a little bit with, like, I feel like you're like a slippery, slimy snake. Like a greased up pig. I can't grab a hold of it. Not saying you're a pig, but you know what I mean. I just can't, at a minimum, we did find common ground, and I really, really would love to have you back on and dig into this further in the future, man. Is there any place that if people had more questions for you that you would recommend that they go to?
Yeah, sure. Facebook is always a good source for me. I think the two of us are friends, so people can find me through your Facebook. I have an email address. Actually, it's easier because it's posted. It's posted on my Facebook, so that's an easy way to get in touch with me, too. And what I'll say is that I appreciated this as well. And I'm not, as we've sort of talked about before, I'm not interested in sort of convincing you that I'm right. What I'm interested in is, as you said, finding that common ground. I think that what you do is incredible in a very real, way, because you are finding value in places and folk and ideas that others would write off. And I think that if we're going to pull through the next generation of folk, particularly in the United States, we've got to start finding common ground. We've got to stop the violence. And I think the only way we're going to be able to do that is through missions like your own.
Thank you to Alex Moreschi. Thank you for listening. Thank you also to Dave Blair at davefreesong.com/free music. Thank you to our patrons. You too can support us at patreon.com/right and learn more at therighttoreason.com. Next week, we're talking to the former president of American Atheists, Dr. Ed Buckner. He was succeeded by David Silverman. He's going to talk about the controversy around Silverman and where the atheist movement is headed. I'm looking forward to that. Between now and then, remember that you have the right to reason.
Yeah.
do you feel like I was a dick at all? I feel like some of those parts where I'm like,
not at all.
Metaphorically, Alex, I was just, I was actually emotionally engaged in it. So that's the only reason.
No, this is good. This is important. This is exactly what I was talking about.
Okay,
we've got to challenge each other, right? We have to challenge each other in love. There's a loving way to challenge each other.
I
know it's kind of a joke, but like I tell my friends I love them. It changes things. It makes a difference. It's so funny because thank you for this. This has meant a lot to me because
really?
Right before I got on the line with you, I had just messaged someone ranting, frankly, about atheists. Mm-hmm. And I'm the only theist that wrote on here, which is worth noting. All of the other responses are atheists saying things like the word hysterical, the level of blatant ignorance is so imbued with them. Somebody called me a unreasonable cunt here.
Yeah, atheists are dicks sometimes, man.
The kind of bashing that has come into it, and when I started saying that I reject the question, that I don't think that God is something that we can prove or disprove, that implies that it's empirical. The guy that posted it comes back on and go, well, you're just avoiding the question that you don't want to answer. It's a simple question. You need to answer it now. And then like somebody else comes on. It's like, in defense of Alex, he just doesn't know any better. I was a Christian once too, and now I am enlightened and know better.
Condescending and shit.
Oh no, super condescending. And I'm just
Can't talk to people like that. You can't talk to people like that. You just can't.
Well, you can, and we have to. I have to. I have to keep trying.
Just ask them if there's legitimately two genders. That's how you get back at an atheist. You make them start eating one another. And then later they all start fighting one another, and you're like, all right, I'm out. Thanks, guys.
Yep. Well, gender is a great example, because gender's not real.
Oh, God.
It's okay. Not.
We're going to have that's a...
You're
a postmodernist. You're a postmodernist.
Maybe now.
You're a Foucault kind of dude.
She's been living under a rock since eternity.